Ever wonder how this turns into this? Well, in today's video, I'm going to be talking all about the metamorphism of pelitic rocks or shale and clay containing rocks. Before we jump right into their metamorphism and kind of the stages they go through compositionally during each grade or facies of metamorphism, let's talk a little bit about the composition of pelitic rocks, especially the protolith, and then what that has in store for the metamorphosed pelitic rock or metapelitic rock that it ends up becoming. Prior to metamorphism, shale consists of minerals like kaolinite, montmorillonite, which those are clay minerals, then also carbonate minerals, sometimes usually anchorite, which its composition is shown here, and often very fine-grained quartz and feldspar. And if you've ever seen shale, you probably noticed that it either has a very black color or a red tinge to it. And that's because the black is due to organic matter and the red is due to oxidized iron or hematite, which is a mineral that contains oxidized iron. And in the black shales where there's no red, it's reduced because there's no oxidized minerals like iron. And in that case, the iron is present as pyrite or reduced iron sulfide. Overall, if we had all of these components together of shales and eventually their metamorphic equivalents, pelitic and metapelitic systems require at least 10 chemical components. That is sodium, potassium, calcium, iron, magnesium, aluminum, titanium, silicon, and water. So throughout the rest of the slides, we'll be talking about different mineralogical transitions throughout the metamorphism of shales. And in doing so, in transitioning minerals, you'll see that all of the minerals involve one or more of these components. During low-grade metamorphism, which low-grade refers to lower temperatures and pressures than high-grade, which is high-grade temperatures and pressures, you have these facies, which refer to the low-grade side of the metamorphic scale, and these are the zeolite facies and the greenschist facies. If we look at the figure to the bottom right, we can see that diagenesis is kind of that first crossing the line from diagenesis over into metamorphism, and then you have the zeolite facies, and then there's this PNP here we'll get to later on, but then you also have the greenschist facies, and these zeolite and greenschist facies are typically thought of as pretty low grade. The amphibole, granulite, eclogite, all those facies are higher grade facies. So during the zeolite facies, this blue band here, we have the montmorillonite disappear, and it is replaced by chlorite and illite. Then in the greenschist facies, illite becomes enriched in aluminum and potassium, and eventually is replaced by muscovite. And if we look over here to the bottom left figure, we can see that there's a chlorite and muscovite band here, and then a bunch of other bands listing minerals as we go to increasing grade or facies of metamorphism, aka increasing temperature and pressure. And we'll talk about each of these zones of transition into, you know, chlorite, muscovite, biotite, garnet, staurolite, kyanite, and sillimanite in a second. But the other thing I want to mention is that we already established that over here to the left, the lowest grade of metamorphism, that's bounded by a line between diagenesis and metamorphism, which we drew in the first metamorphic petrology video. I'll link it up here if you want to check that out. But also, it's bounded to the right by melting, and that's igneous activity. So remember, if stuff fully melts and then fully recrystallized, that's an igneous rock now. If it doesn't fully melt and it just is transitioned to different minerals because of high temperature and pressure without fully melting, that's metamorphism. So we're in this little zone here between diagenesis, a sedimentary process, and melting, an igneous process. But before we jump into those other mineralogical transitions, let me back up here and just allow me to explain why temperature and pressure causes new minerals to form. If you've taken any chemistry classes or just seen anybody talk about thermodynamics ever, there's a thing called activation energy, where reactions may be thermodynamically favorable, i.e. the energy of the reactants is greater than that of the energy of the products, and we want to go down in energy to become more stable. However, even if the products are lower in energy, aka thermodynamically favorable for the reaction to proceed and form the products, there is often a hump of energy to overcome before the reactants can go over to the product side, and that hump is called activation energy. This activation energy must be overcome in order for the reactants to become the products, and raising temperature and or pressure can provide enough energy to overcome these barriers, these activation energy barriers, and the reactions can proceed, and that can allow new minerals to form. And as you'll see, some of the minerals that will form along this low-grade metamorphic trend will transform into other minerals down the line with even higher grade metamorphism or higher temperatures and pressures, because even though one activation energy hump has been overcome by low-grade metamorphism, it might just be an intermediate to a better, more stable product that then that energy barrier can be overcome by even higher temperatures and pressures, and then it can go to that one. And then another one maybe can be overcome to a final stable product that won't transition no matter the temperature or whatever. And that brings me to these mineralogical transitions once again. And because these new minerals form systematically, it's not random process. They always form in the same sequence at the same general temperature and pressure range. And because it's systematic with increasing metamorphic grade, zones have been defined for the first appearance of key minerals as listed in this graph. These are called Barrovian zones, and this whole process of these metamorphic mineralogical transitions during the metamorphism of shales is Barrovian metamorphism. And the zones include the chlorite zone, the biotite zone, the garnet zone, the staurolite zone, the kyanite zone, and the sillimanite zone. So let's start with the biotite zone. In the lower greenschist facies before biotite comes in, as we mentioned, the common assemblage is muscovite, chlorite, and quartz. If you've seen my practice identification video, you know that I showed you a bunch of thin sections and we talked about the minerals in them. So I'm just going to kind of show you and label the thin sections on here, but not really focus on those. I'm just going to pop them up when I talk about certain assemblages, and then you can watch that video for a more in-depth practice video on identifying minerals in thin section. However, in the biotite zone, after the lower greenschist facies, once the biotite does come into play, the assemblage becomes muscovite, chlorite, quartz, and biotite. This biotite zone also marks the disappearance of K-spar or potassium feldspar, which was present or is sometimes present in the lower greenschist facies before biotite comes in. And then this potassium feldspar doesn't actually reappear in Barrovian metamorphism of Pelitic rocks until the highest limits of the amphibolite facies. So it has to be really high grade for the K-spar to reappear. And lastly, for the biotite zone, in the low temp biotite zone, iron rich rocks may contain stilnomelane. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, but we're going to go with it, which looks like biotite, but is more siliceous, less potassic, and more hydrous. Next, the garnet zone marks obviously the first appearance of garnet, which is initially rich in both iron and magnesium, and as grade increases, as temperature and pressure increases, magnesium content decreases inside the garnet, and we can actually observe this in individual zoned garnets. If you look at this figure here, we can see cores rich in manganese. Did I say magnesium earlier? I meant manganese and iron, not magnesium and iron. The manganese is rich in the cores of the garnets when it's lower temperature and pressure, and as the grade increases, the rims become more rich in iron and more poor in manganese. The common assemblage in this zone is muscovite, quartz, garnet, biotite, and sometimes K-spar. However, this assemblage is kind of actually not Pelitic, technically, by definition. It's semi-Pelitic, because true Pelitic rocks must contain at least one extra aluminous mineral other than garnet. But in an aluminum-rich bulk composition, the typical assemblage in this garnet zone would be muscovite, quartz, chlorite, pyrophyllite, and sometimes chloritoid. The starlite zone is kind of boring. All I have to say about it is that it's the first appearance of starlite and biotite containing Pelitic rocks. You can see the starlite kind of twinned in this thin section, the cross of yellowish mineral here under cross polars. And then the kyanite zone is the first appearance of kyanite in biotite-bearing Pelitic rocks. The kyanite-forming reaction actually represents the beginning of the disappearance of chlorite. With increasing grade, the chlorite stability field shrinks. But as grade increases even more, the kyanite structurally transitions into a different polymorph of the same mineral, sillimanite. If you're not sure what polymorphs are, I have a whole video about polymorphism. I'll link it up here if you want to check it out. It's basically when minerals have the same composition but a different structure. So kyanite and sillimanite have the same composition but a different structure. And with increasing pressure and temperature, that structure of kyanite becomes unstable and the structure of sillimanite becomes more stable. So it transitions to sillimanite, but it remains the same composition. This sillimanite zone, which is the transition of kyanite to sillimanite, also marks the disappearance of staurolite. And the common assemblage in this zone is muscovite, quartz, biotite, sillimanite, and garnet. However, at higher grades still, muscovite disappears and case bar reappears. As I mentioned, the case bar can reappear at the highest grades of the amphipolite facies. This is when we get our familiar gneiss assemblage. That is gneiss that forms from really high-grade metamorphism of pelitic protoliths rather than the gneiss that forms from the metamorphism of granite, for example. Gneiss can form in multiple ways. But this assemblage that is common at very, very high grades of metamorphism when case bar reappears is quartz, biotite, sillimanite, case bar, and garnet, as we can see in these two thin sections where you have a typical gneissic composition. Now, going back to the facies for a second, I want to kind of relate these zones when the minerals show up to facies so that we're not confused between zones and facies and grades, because there's a lot of terms for kind of the same thing here. So in the zeolite and P&P facies, as shown in this graph, the P&P stands for prehnite pumpolite facies, clays such as mostly illite are present. And as we increase in grade into the Barrovian series, we get chlorite and biotite. Obviously, those were the first zones, chlorite zone and then the biotite zone. And these don't come in until the greenschist facies. So Barrovian metamorphism of pelitic rocks doesn't really start until the lower greenschist or even kind of mid to upper greenschist facies. And then in the amphibolite facies, which is much higher grade, pretty much any of these reactions or mineralogical transitions that we talked about in the Barrovian metamorphism of pelitic rocks can take place in the amphibolite facies. So any pelitic assemblage is kind of possible, but it depends where you are in the amphibolite facies. So as you can see, the amphibolite facies and all of these facies are a bit broader than the zones we were just talking about that are common for pelitic metamorphism. And then the granulite facies, there's two main assemblages that can be present for pelitic rocks in this facies. This is over here in the really high temperature grade metamorphism. And the two assemblages that are common depend on pressure. So if you are in the granulite facies and you are less than 10 kilobars in pressure, an assemblage of case bar, garnet, cordierite, biotite, and orthopyroxene is typical. And if you're over 10 kilobars in pressure, you'll get assemblage in the granulite facies of orthopyroxene and kyanite. And guys, by the way, when I talk about these assemblages, it's not like the only thing that can happen in that zone or grade of metamorphism, but it's typical of that zone. And then other minor constituents can be present, obviously, but these would be the dominant type of minerals in that zone. Then moving to the blue schist facies, all the way from the high temperature side of the facies graph to the low-ish temperature side, where the blue schist facies is high grade, but like high grade pressure-wise, not so much temperature-wise. And in this facies, there's a lack of biotite, but garnet is present. There's potentially stilnomaline, chloritoid, and or sodic amphiboles. And lastly, the high-grade eclogite facies, which is high grade both in temperature and definitely in pressure. The eclogite facies is similar to blue schist assemblages for pelitic rocks, but with chlorite, fungite, and quartz dominating, and sometimes the high-pressure quartz polymorph, structural high-pressure quartz mineral, cosite is present, and then you know it had to be really high pressure. If you haven't noticed already, pressure seems to heavily control mineral assemblages in metapelitic rocks, and you're right, it really does. For example, at less than 4.5 kilobars, andalusite, the third polymorph of kyanite and sillimanite, is present instead of kyanite or sillimanite. And at less than 4 kilobars, cordierite may be present instead of garnet or staurolite, but I don't want to make it sound like it's all dependent on pressure and nothing else, because cordierite could technically be stable at higher pressures up to 10 kilobars if composition is such that the iron magnesium ratio is low, or if temperature is high. So bulk chemical composition and temperature also play a role in addition to pressure. However, because pressure does play such an integral role, 6 bathozones or pressure regions have been defined for certain mineral assemblages that typically occur within those zones, and we'll talk about those now. In bathozone 1, at around less than 3 kilobars of pressure, andalusite and K-spar dominate, and cordierite is common, and staurolite is very rare. At around 3 kilobars, right at the boundary between bathozone 1 and 2, sillimanite can be present instead of andalusite. Again, this is just a higher pressure polymorph of andalusite. In bathozone 2, from around 3 to 4 kilobars of pressure, andalusite and biotite are present at low temperatures, and sillimanite and muscovite at high temperatures. And in bathozone 3, from 4 to 6 kilobars of pressure, the assemblage of muscovite, staurolite, and chlorite breaks down to sillimanite and biotite. Andalusite is not stable with biotite in this pressure zone. In bathozone 4, from 6 to 7 kilobars of pressure, staurolite and chlorite transition into kyanite and biotite. And at high temperatures in this zone, garnet, muscovite, and sillimanite assemblages form. In bathozone 5, from around 7 to 9 kilobars of pressure, staurolite and muscovite transition to garnet, kyanite, and biotite. The common assemblage in this zone is garnet, staurolite, kyanite, and biotite. So as you can see, when I have this arrow here, it doesn't mean that the staurolite and muscovite have to disappear. Staurolite can obviously coexist with garnet, kyanite, and biotite in this assemblage. And at the last bathozone, the highest pressure zone, over around 9 kilobars of pressure, K-spar, potassium feldspar, and kyanite coexist. Sillimanite is rare but possible only at the highest temperature range of this zone, around 750 to 800 degrees Celsius in this pressure zone, sillimanite may occur. Now, you might think that it seemed like the higher grade you go, kyanite transitioned to sillimanite, so why at high pressures is it more rare than kyanite? Well, if we look at the kyanite, sillimanite, andalusite pressure temperature diagram, you can easily see that it's not only dependent on increasing pressure, but also increasing temperature. So if we look at increasing temperature, both kyanite and andalusite do want to transition to sillimanite. But if we look at increasing pressure on the y-axis, you can see that sillimanite can sometimes go back to kyanite if the temperature is high, but the pressure is even higher. So only over here at the upper right corner can sillimanite be present at very high pressures, and that requires temperatures to be extremely high. However, at lower temperatures, it's probably going to be kyanite at the higher pressures rather than sillimanite. I talk about this and other polymorphic pressure temperature diagrams in that polymorphism video. But in general, all these mineralogical transitions require taking into account both temperature and pressure. These were just a list of assemblages that are common in certain temperature, pressure, Barrovian zones or pressure, bathozones, or facies, temperature and pressure zones, of metamorphic grade during metamorphism of Pelitic rocks. So that is all I have for this video. If you'd like to check out my major reference for this and other videos in this playlist and the igneous playlist as well, you can check it out in my description down below. It's linked down below. It's called The Essentials of Igneous and Metamorphic Petrology. And with that, I say upcoming here, but these are not upcoming videos. They're actually already out on my channel, been out for a while, and I meant to put related videos here. I don't know what I'm going to do next for the metamorphic petrology playlist, so comment down below what you'd like me to do. I have ideas, but I haven't started them yet, so I don't have them listed here. I also just realized this says historical geology playlist. Wow, I'm all over the map today for my inside, but it's supposed to say metamorphic petrology playlist. You can watch my historical geology playlist if that interests you, but what will show up here in a few seconds or now is the metamorphic petrology playlist if you want more videos like this one. And with that, guys, I thank you guys so much for watching, and I can't wait to see you guys in the next one. Bye!